Hi everyone, this is Ezekiel O'Callaghan with Raptor Chatter, and firstly, I would like to apologize for not uploading. My wife and I were on vacation, and so weren't able to get videos done. However, now that we're back, ready to start the month with April in review. This April had a lot of really big finds, including the find of one of the biggest things to ever live in our ocean. An ichthyosaur jawbone from the late Triassic came from a creature that was estimated to be almost 25 meters long, or 85 feet. The only thing that we know of that would be larger than this in the fossil record would be things like our modern day blue whales and other baleen whales. Being so large and so new to science, it's given new ideas as to just what these Mesozoic reptiles could do and how large they might have evolved. According to one paper published this month, there were about 5 million years between the end of the Permian extinction and the recovery of the marine species. And this is specifically due to anoxic events in the oceans, that is, not having enough oxygen in the oceans to support life. Looking at oceanic sediments from the early Triassic of Iran, scientists were able to correlate the anoxic events with the extinctions of several different types of ammonite in the early Triassic, showing how these later anoxic events helped to stunt and slow down the progression and recovery of marine life after the Permian extinction. If you were to imagine a lizard with four eyes, this probably isn't what you'd imagine. A species from 49 million years ago was found to have two different pineal eyes. And while some species today are known for having that third eye, a pineal eye, this species had the two holes in the skull which showed there were two, helping to lead understanding and development of how reptile skulls evolved, and helping to say that reptile skulls aren't necessarily the best analog we have to other species like amphibians, which also have pineal eyes. Dinosaurs were just one small part of the group called archosaurs during the early and mid-Triassic, before expanding and dominating the planet during the late Triassic. This dominance and diversity from that dominance seems to stem from the Carnian Pluvial episode, a period where Earth's environment went from very arid to very humid, and then back to arid again. And this just helps us to understand how the dinosaurs were able to gain dominance over their relatives, which were also doing very well at the time, and then dominate the planet for a further 140 million years, helping to shape much of the history of life on Earth. For a different look at paleontology, we're gonna look at the International Journal of Astrobiology, which asked the question, would we be able to tell if there was an industrial culture 420 million years ago, during the Silurian? They came up with the answer that no, you wouldn't be able to tell. Any sort of leftover sediments from that time period would be indistinguishable from all the background events that already happen on a normal basis on Earth. And that means for our time period, the Anthropocene, we may not leave behind a major mark in the sediments and the rocks of the Earth, at least compared to the normal behaviors of the Earth. On the other hand, normal behaviors on the Earth have also killed off 90% of life at times, so we should temper this with caution and still do what we can to limit our impact on the global climate. Another study looked at the teeth of ceruleosaurs, one branch of the theropod group of dinosaurs, to try and understand how exactly they ate. It found that the puncture and pull tactics work best, meaning that they would puncture and then pull right back out. This study looked at a wide variety of species, including the tyrannosaurid Gorgosaurus, the dromaeosaurs Dromaeosaurus and Sauronitholestes, and the troodontid Troodon. Based on what they found, Troodon would have had the weakest teeth for this method of eating, meaning that it may have filled a different niche in the environment which many of these species are found in, meaning it could have been anything from a scavenger to just eating smaller prey, rather than the larger prey that it seems the dromaeosaurs and the tyrannosaurs ate. Further study of teeth looked at the calcium isotopes found in certain species, particularly in North Africa. So this would be species like Spinosaurus, Carcharodontosaurus, and Sarcosuchus, all very large, 40-foot long plus predators in North Africa during the early and mid-Cretaceous. By analyzing the calcium content and the chemical makeup of the teeth, the scientists are able to compare that to modern-day species to get a better understanding of what exactly their preferred prey was. So for things like Carcharodontosaurus and some of the Abelosaurs, which also lived in the area, it was found that they had teeth most suited to eating land-based prey, whereas something like Sarcosuchus had teeth suited to both fish, aquatic prey, and land-based prey. And meanwhile, Spinosaurus potentially had a diet consisting entirely of fish, based on the chemical analysis of the teeth. And this shows the potential for resource partitioning in an environment to allow multiple very large predators to survive alongside one another, just as it may have shown with Troodon in the previous study. The extinctions of the megafauna, like mastodons, mammoths, and ground sloths at the end of the last ice age, has been under question as to its exact cause, with many scientists suggesting human hunting caused many of these extinctions. However, there's been little direct evidence of human hunting on some of these species. Footprints from White Sands National Monument in New Mexico have shown the pathways that a giant ground sloth took 15,000 years ago, and also the same pathways that a human hunter took during the same time. Some of the human footprints were found inside of footprints made by the giant ground sloth, meaning these were made in a very close time proximity to one another. Additionally, there seemed to be flailing circles where the sloth would rear up and try and flail at other hunters approaching from another direction, showing some inherent self-defense in the ground sloth as it knew this was a predation attempt. And so the idea that human pressures are causing extinctions is gaining momentum still, and it could even still be happening today. Thank you everyone for watching. I want to apologize one more time for not having videos up for a while. We will have a video over the vacation we took because we did stop at the Fukui Prefectural Dinosaur Museum in Japan. And so we'll do a review of that because it was a fantastic museum. And me being me, take care, be safe, don't go extinct.